Well, hello, everyone, and welcome to today's LinkedIn Live. My name is Jay Huff, and I am the Director of Technology Services here at MPI. And you guys are in for a real treat today as we chat with the one and only Amani Roberts as he shares some insights from one of his brand new signature programs and upcoming book, Resilient and Brilliant, 7 Ways to Unlock Your Creativity. You've had the pleasure of tuning in to either of our last two WEC digital experiences from Louisville or Mexico. You'll immediately recognize Amani as our WEC digital experience host. That's how I've gotten to know him. And right off the bat, I was impressed with the intentionality of what he brought to the WEC digital experience. His interviews were thorough, but relaxed, whether it was someone he just met or someone he'd known for a long time. He made it an enjoyable experience. I had to know more about who this Amani Roberts is. So I read his book, DJs Mean Business. Yes. And I quickly learned that, like my favorite cartoon growing up, there's more to Amani Roberts than meets the eye. Amani Roberts is an internationally renowned speaker, professor, DJ, and author who has awakened hospitality and music professionals' dormant creativity for years. As a professional speaker for thousands worldwide, Amani has left an indelible mark on audiences by combining music and nostalgia to reconnect them to their most creative selves. Throughout his illustrious career in hospitality and music, Amani has collaborated with industry giants such as Marriott, 7-Eleven, Chartmetric, Meeting Professionals International, PCMA, Calendly, and the American Hotel and Lodging Association. Amani holds a master's in music business from the Berklee College of Music, complemented by his education at Scratch Academy and Howard University, where he earned a Bachelor of Business Administration in Hospitality Management. Widely regarded as an authority in his field, Amani Roberts leverages his extensive experience in education to provide the ability to see different possibilities that have been hidden in plain sight. His innovative approach and deep understanding for the industry position him as the go-to expert for unlocking creativity in the ever-evolving hospitality and music business landscape. So without further ado, I would like to introduce Amani Roberts. Welcome, Amani. How are you doing today?
I'm doing well. Thank you very much, Jay. But you didn't share who's your favorite cartoon character. You mentioned that, but
it's the Transformers, man. More than meets the eye. You know, Autobots wage their battles against the evil forces of the Decepticons.
Yes. Okay. Okay. Good. Good. Just wanted to check. But thank you for that intro. I got to take you on the road with me. That was tremendous. I appreciate it. And so I'm excited to share one of my new kind of signature programs today. And we'll get the slides on the screen. Thank you very much. And really, it's Resilient and Brilliant, 7 Ways to Unlock Your Creativity. So we'll get to it. Jay and I will go back and forth with asking questions. Make sure you put some things in the chat there, although I don't see the chat, I have to pull it up, but Jay will help me. And let's go. So let me get right here. Okay. So growing up, I grew up in the Washington, D.C. area. I grew up right in Silver Spring, Maryland, and I grew up in a strict household. My dad was very strict with me. If you look at this picture, I'm in the back row, kind of, well, not the middle row right there. And it was so strict when I was growing up that when I would go out and we'd have dinner at home, I could have one glass of punch, only one glass of punch. I could watch one TV show a week. That was the Cosby Show on Thursdays.
Nice.
It was tough. It was tough.
It's must-see TV, though.
It was must-see TV back then, for sure, for sure. Yes. What's up, Virginia? But one thing that, you know, I would work, I had my own lawn mowing business. I would also work and shovel snow when it was wintertime. My dad would take the money from me and he would deposit it in the bank. I put that in quotes because I'll get back to that. And, but the one good thing that my dad did do is he introduced me to music and instruments. He encouraged me to start playing instruments when I was young. I first started playing the flute, and that lasted about 6 months, and I quickly transformed to the saxophone because I felt that was more, you know, yes, masculine.
Transformed.
Form. Yes, there you go. I see that's a play on the phrase. Yes. Also, as you see this picture, this is a soccer team. I grew up playing traveling soccer. We went all over the country, primarily up and down the East Coast, and that was where my dad really, he exposed me to music. We'd have to go on long road trips because we weren't that well off of a family, so we had to drive most cities, most places, whether it be Raleigh, Georgia, Pennsylvania, all those East Coast cities. One time a year, we got to fly to Tampa Bay, Florida for a tournament, but during these road trips, I got exposed to music, and that was where I first kind of understood creativity, the music landscape, and everything like that. Once I kind of got a little older, I went to work at a local grocery store called Snyder's, and that was also where I began to acquire my CD collection. I would take all my money and just buy CDs and just start to listen to music. And so it started to grow. It started to grow more and more. My dad, he was a professor at Howard University. He taught in the psychology department. And so, you know, me being a rebel, I wanted to be as far away from him as possible. So I applied and got soccer scholarships to four Division I schools. But I want you to guess where I ended up going to school. Ended up going to Howard because of free tuition, walking onto the soccer team. I picked a major that was as far away from psychology as possible, business, hospitality management, and finance. My dad pledged a fraternity. He was Phi Beta Sigma. I wanted nothing to do with that. And then when I graduated, I tried to get as far away as possible. So there's a little bit of a rebel theme here. I went to Atlanta, then Chicago, then Dallas, Miami. Eventually, I returned, but yes. But one thing that I was able to take with me that he did give me when I was traveling and moving around was just my exposure to music and exposure to creativity. So one thing and one quote I love to share is what Albert Einstein said. He said, creativity is intelligence having fun. I love this quote because it's true. And one thing that I found, particularly with hospitality professionals, is that nowadays we've lost our creativity. It's gone dormant. We've forgotten how to be creative. The creativity of our youth when we were 10 or 11 years old is gone. And my mission and my goal in life is to help people, professionals like us who are here trying to either get their new job, close a big piece of business. Maybe they're trying to, make a presentation that will be memorable. Is my goal and my mission is to help people unlock their creativity. I do it through music and nostalgia, which you'll experience. And that's what we're going to talk about today. I have a proprietary method called Copper's methodology. I'm going to walk you through the 7 kind of steps to it and everything. If you have questions or thoughts, put it in the chat. It's going to be very interactive. And I do want to share with you that I'm not going to be able to cover everything today. So as you're watching, if you're interested in learning more, that's my email address. You put the subject more, your first name, and then I can send you more information. We can talk more. But I want to share that early because we're not going to be able to cover everything. We're probably going to be able to cover, 2 out of the 7 kind of facts or the parts of the modules, but I wanted to share that with you also. So first, we're going to get to taking creative risks. So this is one of my favorite kind of the 7 steps, taking creative risks. And I want to ask you, when you think of Earth, Wind, and Fire, what song comes to mind? I'm going to play the song that comes to mind when I think of them. Yes. So that was September, Earth, Wind, and Fire. That is one of their most famous, legendary, historic songs. But I bet you weren't aware that Earth, Wind, and Fire took a lot of creative risks when they were on tour with their music, with the people in their band. One of my favorite stories of theirs is when they were on tour in 1978, they worked with a magician by the name of Doug Henning, and he helped them create a floating pyramid that was like an illusion in their show. They would be in spacesuits and they would kind of hop in between the pyramid, and it just really created something that was memorable and legendary. Now, Doug Henning was a famous magician in his day. He had a TV show, I believe, on NBC. He was very popular. He had an assistant. I wonder if you know who his assistant was. His assistant was David Copperfield. So David Copperfield, they helped, they worked with Earth, Wind, and Fire, and they worked so closely together that when Earth, Wind, and Fire, they were honored at the Kennedy Center Honors in 2019, David Copperfield was the one who introduced them. So that's how close they worked. And so that was a creative risk that they took, and it paid off in spades for them. Now, I have another example for you in terms of creative risks. We go to the 90s, we have the group TLC. So first thing they did with creative risk is that if you see the costume in the middle, we have left eye. She will wear condoms on her clothing and her eye. And that was never done before. It was huge risk, but they did it to promote a message. And it was a massive creative risk that worked out for them. The second creative risk that I really love what they did is that I'm going to play you a video, and then I'm going to tell you what they did with this song also. Don't go chasing waterfalls. Please stick So that song right there, Waterfalls, in that song, if you remember, this was the first number one song in history to refer to AIDS in one of its verses. It also talked about a lot of controversial topics in the song, like domestic abuse, things like that. And it was a massive creative risk. It ended up propelling them and becoming one of the songs of the century. I want to say it was like the number one, number two song of the decade. And that was another creative risk. So I have a question for you as you're watching. What do you think prevents people from taking creative risks? What's your first thought when you hear this, Jay?
Fear of failure.
There you go. Fear of failure. So you could put some other thoughts in the chat if you like. What prevents people from taking creative risks? Here are the top four things. Just how Jay said, number one, fear. Fear right there. Imposter syndrome, which is one that we can talk about. It really pops up here and there. Self-doubt, not feeling that you're worthy of what you could be doing. And then worry. Worrying about what people think. Yes, yes. Who said fear in the chat there? Those are the top four reasons that prevent people from taking creative risks. And so I'm just going to share with you. Here are three kind of creative risks that I've taken. As Jay mentioned, and he read it too, you know, I wrote the book. I wrote the book back in 2018, 2019. It came out April 14th, 2020, so right in the middle of the pandemic. Budget's another good one too there. I see that. I create a podcast and work on a podcast with my friend and colleague, Mandy Graziano. And so that's another creative risk that I take that you could take. And then I also, teaching is the third one, which I'm going to get to in a little bit. But it's the one thing, you know, whether it's fear, worry, self-doubt, imposter syndrome that prevents us from taking creative risks. So I encourage you to write down right now three creative risks that you have thought about but have not taken action on yet. And if you're so inspired, put it in the chat so we can talk about it. But yes, three creative risks that maybe you thought about but you haven't taken action on yet. So next. All right, number two. The seven steps to unlock your creativity, collaborating with others. I think this is an underrated one that isn't done frequently enough. And I have a question for you. So this here is Kool & the Gang. If you're a fan of Kool & the Gang, put a K and a T and a G in the chat if you like. And then put your favorite Kool & the Gang song in the chat. So I want to tell you a story about how Kool & the Gang was able to collaborate with other people that really helped them level up. Now, their biggest hit, when they first started out, their biggest hit got to be this song right here, Jungle Boogie, which reached number four in the Hot 100 charts. Jungle Boogie. Yes, thank you, Jenny. Yes, there you go. KTG, I love it. Put it in the chat there. This song, they got to number four, but they kind of hit a wall. And they started to become a little bit out of favor, so to speak, during the disco era. So what they did is they had to collaborate with someone else. So I'm going to show you this picture here. And let me, there you go, Get Down On It. That's one of my favorite songs there. If you look in the middle, you'll see JT Taylor. So they brought in JT Taylor as the lead singer. And they collaborated with him. And they also, who's not pictured, I did add a picture of him, is they collaborated with Yumir Diodata. I hope I pronounced his name right. He's from Brazil, and he came from the jazz world. So what they did is they thought outside the box. They collaborated with other people. And what ended up happening was, after this collaboration, you know the song, Celebrate, right here. So they hit... Yes, Jay. So they hit number one on the chart, and you know, you can see some of the artists that they were competing against. This was February 14th, 1981. Then after that, they got to number, I think they got to number two with Joanna. Yes. So that's there. And then after that, they had another hit here, Cherish, right here. So yes, that was Cherish right there. That was an example of how they collaborate with others and it got them to level up. So as you're thinking about your business, your profession, who is someone that you can collaborate with, particularly if they work in a similar space that you work with, that you can collaborate with immediately? A lot of times we think that there's competition and we can't collaborate with people. But what I've learned is that if you collaborate with people who are in your same space, you all will actually propel each other to get to further heights. Further Heights. I agree. That is a bop. So who is it that you can? And then my favorite thing is kind of we say, you know, sports world and music world is there's enough pie for everyone to eat. That's the sweet potato pie. That's one of my specialties. I love to cook it. But yes, so there's enough pie for everyone to eat. So who can you collaborate with? Write that down. And maybe it'll help propel both you and that person to even bigger heights. Okay. Next up is persistence in our seven steps. Number three, persistence. Now, one of my favorite stories here is who here in the chat, if you're a fan of the Supremes, put an S in the chat. The Supremes, here's one of my favorite Supreme songs. So that's the Supremes right there. Many of you might not realize that, you know, the Supremes, okay. They were founded, there you go. They were founded in 1959. When they started working for Motown, Barry Gordy was a little bit lukewarm on them and he didn't really like give them a lot of love. If we were being pretty simple, he didn't give them a lot of love. But what he let them do is he would let them just clap, do hand claps on records. That's all. They would be recording. He let them be the people clapping the hands on the records. From there, they went on to sing background vocals. So they kind of graduated to the next level, singing background vocals in 61. Then they were allowed to record and release their music, but none of their music did well. None of it did well. So they had a little nickname internally at Motown where they called them the No-Hit Supremes. However, they were persistent and they kept at it. They kept working their craft. And then in 1964, they had their first number one hit. And they went on an unprecedented run of 10 of their next 13 songs. They hit number one in the charts starting in 1964. That's an unprecedented run that really has never been duplicated before. And something that's also very rare due to their persistence is that the last song they released before Diana Ross went solo, Someday We'll Be Together, also went number one. That's very rare because most times groups will fade away and their last hit will kind of miss the charts and nothing. No, they because they are persistent, they ended up on the top of the charts. So here's your homework. I'm giving you a lot of homework as you go, the professor and me, but create an idea journal. This will help you be more persistent with ideas and just being more persistent in general. And usually when you wake up in the morning, add 3 to 4 new ideas daily, as soon as you wake up. And if you keep writing this, usually what happens is the first 20 ideas you have are okay, they're okay. But usually you get to the real gold once you get to idea between like 25 and 30. So that's your homework right there. Remember the Supremes when you remember persistence. Okay. For me personally, one idea I've been sitting on for a long time is doing a documentary based on my book that's coming out called The Quiet Storm. That idea I've been sitting on, but I need to take action. So for me, I have to be persistent and take action. Think about what's one idea that you've been thinking about forever, the last months or years, and you've been sitting on, and how can you take action right there? One of my favorite quotes from Dr. Miles Monroe. He says, the richest place on earth is the graveyard because where you will find all the hopes and dreams that were never fulfilled. The books that were never written, the songs that were never sung, all because someone was afraid to take that first step. So be persistent, take the first step, and just remember the graveyard when you come to that.
That's all right, powerful.
Yes, thank you. Next is resilience. So this is a good one here too. And this is one of my favorite examples. I'm going to kind of dig deep into the crates, as us DJs say. We're talking about practice resilience. Who here, if you're a fan of the Whispers, put a W in the chat. If you're a fan of the Whispers, put a W in the chat. Mm-hmm. And this right here is I'm going to kind of take you through the timeline for the Whispers right here. Okay. So this one, it just really, really, they released their first single in 1964. The number one show in 1964 was Bonanza, okay? Bonanza, I've never seen it. I got to go back and look at it. That was it. They got their first Hot 100 single, which only went to number 50 in 1970. The top show in 1970 was Marcus Welby, MD, okay? Then you fast forward. So now we're 12 years later in 1976. They had their fifth Hot 100 single, One for the Money. It reached number 88 on the charts. The number one song this year was Happy Days. Now, they've been 12 years. They still have not cracked the top 20. Finally, 13 or 15 years after they had their first single, they had their first top 20 single, and the beat goes on right here. So for some of you, this song might sound familiar. I should get it. But if you remember the Will Smith hit Miami, he gets beat here. And that's why the song had a renaissance. And then finally, 23 years later, they had their first top 10 single, Rock Steady, in 1987, where the number one show on TV was The Cosby Show. So this is a true example of just resilience. It's amazing. 23 years from the time they started to getting their first top 10 hit. Nowadays, I don't think a record label would let you stay, you know, keep, you know, none of the groups don't stay active if they don't have a hit within 1 or 2 years. But this is a true example of resilience. Now, I have another example I want to share with you. And also what I recommend if you're trying to learn about resilience and maybe acquire some more resilience is to read autobiographies. I think they're very powerful. Here are three of my favorite autobiographies. One is The Life of Luther Vandross. The middle one is Ben Hogan, which I'll get to next. And the third one is Charlie Wilson from the Gap Band. Those are three of my favorite autobiographies. But I want to talk about Ben Hogan for a minute. Famous golfer right here. This is his career. So in 1930, he turned pro. It took him 8 years to join the PGA Tour. He won his first tournament 10 years after turning pro in 1930. He won his first major tournament in 1946. Won the U.S. Open and the PGA Championship, so two major tournaments in 48. But then, after he was driving home from the Phoenix Open, he suffered a near fatal car accident. What happened is that him and his wife were driving and they hit a Greyhound bus head on. He, as he saw what was happening, he threw himself across the seat to protect his wife as they collided head on with the Greyhound bus. You see a picture of the collision up there. He suffered a double fracture of the pelvis, a fractured collarbone, a left ankle fracture, a chipped rib, and near fatal blood clots. Now, normally, people he wouldn't be golfing anymore. No one would be golfing or doing anything. He went through an extreme rehab of doing a lot of walking. That was what he did. And he came back a little bit over a year later, won the U.S. Open. Then in 1951, which was 2 years after his accident, he won the Masters and the U.S. Open. And then in 1953, he won the Triple Crown of golf, the U.S. Open, the Masters, and the British Open. Ben Hogan is one of my favorite examples in life of resilience because of the journey he went through, how it took a while to win his tournament. Then he had a crash when he almost died, but he still was resilient and came back and did well. So your homework, your next assignment is to select one autobiography to read in the next 4 months and pick your favorite example of resilience from the book. Send it to me. I'm going to give you my email address again later. But I feel that is one of my favorite keys to unlock your creativity is to read autobiographies and learn about resilience right there. All right. Next up, we're going to go. And this is a quote here about resilience from Nelson Mandela. Do not judge me by my success. Judge me by how many times I fell down and got back up again. Now we're going to get to failure here. This is failure. All right. Embracing failure. We all fail. It's how you embrace it. So let's watch this. First of all, you see the group here is Destiny's Child. If you're a fan of Destiny's Child, put a D and a C in the chat. This is them right there. But who here knew that when they were on Star Search with Ed McMahon, they actually lost? So let's watch it really quickly here.
Your challenges are a young group from Houston. Welcome Beyonce, Latvia, Nina, Nikki, Kelly, and Ashley. The hip-hop rapping Girls Time.
All right, so that was a young Beyonce singing lead right there. Kelly Rowland was in that video too. But yes, Fallon, I hope I'm saying your name right. Virginie, Carrie, yes, Destiny's Child's fan. Does anyone know what group they lost to that day? No, if you do put in the chat, they lost to this group called the Skeleton Crew. Have you heard of the Skeleton Crew since then? No, you haven't. So that was them. They do look so young. They do very young. They lost to Skeleton Crew. But really, funny fella. Don't stop. That's the key. Like when we fail, we have to just, you know, they say fall down 7 times, get up 8 times. You have to keep, you cannot stop. That's not the rule. So have a little kind of analysis. Don't give up. Number one for the don't stop is don't give up. And number two, oh, is own it. I love a quote. I believe I heard Les Brown say that. He said, you know, you can have reasons or results. Notice that reasons don't count. So keep that in mind when you want to own it. Got to have a new approach. So look at Destiny's Child and what they did in terms of a new approach. They changed around their members. They kind of cut out the rapping part of it, and they went strictly singing. And I agree, Jenny. So many people. I think Justin Timberlake comes to mind for Star Search. You have to make sure you think critically. You have a good strategy. They had a great strategy where they kind of changed the group members. Like I said, worked on singing, had some guest appearances, and then took action. One thing that helped that hurts us is that many people, when they fail, they just get paralyzed by analyzing why, and they never take action. Outline your plan and then prioritize the response, meaning when you it's time to go, it's go time. Let's go, let's respond. So in the chat, or you can write it down here, I want you to share what is your favorite failure and why. And I'm going to share a quick example of one of my favorite failures and why, because it's going to show you kind of how it helped me grow. So back in 2012, I went to Scratch Academy in Los Angeles. I was, you know, continue to learn how to be a DJ. They have 6 semesters you have to go through for the programming. At the end of the last semester, you have 7 performances. You get a score out of 50 for the first 6. And then the last one is your final exam. You have to score out of 100. You have to get 320 out of the 400 to graduate. These are performances like if I'm DJing in a lounge, what music am I playing? What am I dressed? What do I look like? How are my mixing skills? Is it smooth? Are the blends nice? Then you could have a prime time. I'm headlining at a club. What are the hits I'm playing? You have opening. I'm opening up for us, you know, another DJ or a singer. And you have like opening with requests. So these all these different sets that you have to perform, you could grade it on them. It's very hard because you could be having an off day. Maybe you mess up some of your mixing so it's not smooth. It's just very subjective. It's very difficult. When I got to the end of my final semester, I scored a 318 out of 400. So I didn't pass. They didn't pass me. So I had to decide, am I going to try to go through this process again where I had to take the final class, which is very difficult? Am I going to try to take it again? Or am I just going to take my bag and just go home and forget about it? So I had to embrace the failure. I had to do a couple things in terms of like owning it. I had to realize, okay, I have to get better. I got some help. I took some lessons from one of my now production partners. And then I had to just do it again. And so, yes, Jenny, thank you for sharing that example. And so what happens, I went back and I took the class again, the final class again, and I ended up getting one of the highest scores ever in the class. Now, this is a speech that the instructor—
All semester, this guy was leading his class and leading in the sense of in his own performances. And the scores that he was putting up and his understanding and him demonstrating that he understood these assignments, but also leadership, like leading his classmates, like being there for his classmates, being somebody who could almost act as a spokesman for his classmates and just being a resource for the rest of his class. And I think a lot of the students would agree with me when I say that if there was a valedictorian of this class, that it would be this guy. Amaro, come on up here, man.
That was the story. That was like what the instructor said about me. Very, and just shows you, I embraced there and, you know, I had a high score. I helped, I brought other people with me also. So that was a picture of me here with the graduating. This is my graduating class, but that's how I embraced failure. And that's how I was able to get through. That's my personal example. So make sure, like Jenny in the chat, share your personal example. What's your favorite failure and how did it help you grow? Destiny's Child.
Dark Child 99.
Say my name, no one is around you. Say baby, I love you. You ain't running game. Say my name, you acting kind of shady. Ain't calling me baby, why the sudden change? Say my name, if no one is around you. Say baby, I love you. If you ain't running game. Say my name, name. You acting kind of shady, ain't calling me baby, better say my name.
So once they embraced their failure, they went on a run. They had number one hits, Bills, 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 in 99. They hit number one on the charts. From there, they got Say My Name, I Just Play You, hit number one on the charts in 2000. They won a Grammy for that song right there. And then you keep going, Independent Woman hit number one in January 20, 2001. And I think there's one more here. Yes, Bootylicious hit number one in August of 2001. So that run of four straight number ones, you know, it was phenomenal, and they embraced their failure. They redid how the group was, what they sang about. They guessed it on things. So that's their example, and that's one of my favorite examples of expressing and how they embrace failure and continue to move forward. Because remember what Einstein says, failure is success in progress. Number six, reinvention. This one is a very, very common one nowadays, and you'd be surprised here. I'm sure you all have heard this song here. So that song is Poison by BBD. You hear the song All the Weddings, Every Wedding. It's like, it's still popular now. It's one of the biggest songs in history. But did you know what group Belle Biv DeVoe came from? Some of you might know, but if you didn't, here's a song, one of my favorite songs by this group, New Edition. All right, so this is New Edition right here. If you look far left, that's Ralph Tresvant. Then you have Bobby Brown. We know Bobby Brown. And then you'll have, in one row there, you'll have Ricky Bell, Michael Bivins, and Ronnie DeVoe. What they did is when Ralph Tresvant and Bobby Brown and Johnny Gill, they took a hiatus and went solo, they formed a group called Belle Biv DeVoe. So they reinvented themselves. They reinvented themselves, ended up having two or three massive albums. They still tour with New Edition by themselves. They created the song Poison, which ended up being a massive hit. Like, it's just crazy. So that's the power of reinvention. Now, you might be wondering, like, what does reinvention kind of have to do nowadays? Well, Accenture did a study just this January and said that executives are turning to reinvention as their core strategy, whether they're reinventing their businesses, whether or not they're reinventing, you know, personally, what you're doing. So you can see right there. Then you'll also see here, because change is constant, reinvention never ends. So we're always reinventing ourselves. And now this is a fact that most people might know, but the World Economic Forum says the professionals in the U.S. hold on an average of 12 jobs in a working lifetime. 12 jobs, that's a lot. So my question to you is, what was your most recent reinvention? And then what reinvention would you make if you did not have to worry about money or cachet? I have a fun little graphic here. This is like my reinvention road. I started as a hotel executive for Marriott while I was working for Marriott. I worked for them total almost 20 years. I then learned how to DJ. I went to Scratch Academy. Then I became an author. Then I went to Cal State Fullerton as a professor. Went to Berklee College of Music to further my education. Became a professional speaker. Then during the pandemic, a live streaming podcaster, add that school bus tool belt. So you can see that's 1, 2, 3, 4. That's a good 8 or 9 different reinventions right there. What about you? What are some things that maybe you go to school, take a class, pick up a new skill? How can you reinvent yourself? Because now I'm looking, I'm like, well, what's next for me? I don't know, but we're going to see. We're going to find out. So that's the question right there. What is your next reinvention right there? And that's your homework, to think about that and do that. And then number 7. The final step is staying curious right there. And one of my favorite examples for staying curious is this group right here that has this song here. Where is it? Sly and the Family Songs. So one of the best ways to kind of stay curious is traveling, which we do a lot of in hospitality, and also reading. So this is a quote from Mark Twain where he says, travel is fatal to prejudice, bigotry, and narrow-mindedness. And many of our people need it sorely on these accounts. Broad, wholesome, charitable views of men and things cannot be acquired by vegetating in one's little corner of the earth all in one's lifetime. So that's what it is. And then there was a professor from Columbia Business School that said, travel increases. This is Adam Galinsky, travel increases how flexible you think, helps you connect the dots between concepts at a much deeper level. To get the best out of travel, you need to experience different cultures, immerse yourself, and adapt to different situations. This is how you develop better problem-solving skills and up the ante on your creative output. And then with it comes the World Literacy Foundation. Reading is one of the best ways to foster imagination. Imagination encourages creativity, which brings about new ideas. It also takes a huge part in innovation. Traveling and reading right there. Now, here are three books that I'm recommending to you to spark your creativity. Winnie the Pooh, I'm telling you, don't laugh. Look at it from spark your creativity lens and you'll see. Read Winnie the Pooh. It works. It works. Trust me. Then Maya Angelou, I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. And then one of my favorite books of all time, The Artist's Way by Julia Cameron. If you've read The Artist's Way, put a JC in the chat for Julia Cameron, because this book is phenomenal. And I'm going to share with you one kind of strategy that you can implement today, which is called the artist's date. So what the artist's date is that once a week for, you know, a couple hours, you know, block some time for quiet reflection and inspiration, where you can block out a few hours and go somewhere by yourself to nurture your creativity. So I have a couple examples of where you can go and what you can do for your first. Thank you, Molly, for sharing that. Yes, good reinventions there. Where will you go on your first artist day? Here's some ideas for you. You can go to the beach, go to a museum, try a new restaurant, go to a movie by yourself, and attend an estate or a yard sale. You can work on learning a new language, do a puzzle. There are so many things you can do, but this is a one strategy that I want you to try that will really help you to unlock your creativity, is to consistently go on artist dates right here. I think it's an amazing strategy that you can kind of build in. I know we're busy, we might have kids and families, but try to sneak it in 30 minutes. It's very effective there, because remember, if you stay curious, yes, Trista, thank you for sharing. I agree. If you go and pick a partner, and for 12 weeks, once a week, you go through the chapters and you'll grow. It's amazing chapter. I get a lot of my content from that book. So thank you for mentioning that, Trista. I appreciate it. You want to be in the middle there. I don't know, but I can't find out. So I want you to stay curious and I want you to be powerful. So I want to give you the slides here. So you can scan this QR code, fill out the quick survey, or go to this website here. And I want to give you the slide because there's some links there. And then I'm going to close out with a final story. And then Jay and I will end with some questions. It will be good. But I just want to leave this up here. Molly, thank you for sharing how you left teaching and go into your master's. Yes. So you can scan this code or go to the website there. And I appreciate the feedback. I appreciate the attendance. And then I have a really cool story that's going to bring everything home for you. And then Jay, you still have questions for me, maybe?
Yeah, and I'd love to open up for questions from the audience too. So be thinking about what sorts of questions you might want to ask Amani.
Okay. Yes. So audience, you can put questions here. I'll put that up there. I'll bring the code back to we answer questions. But I want to paint the picture. It was early June 2018, probably like June 8th or whatever, 2018. And I was volunteering at a DJ camp for kids called Camp Spinoff. I was up in Ojai, right outside Santa Barbara in California. My responsibility at this camp was I was a camp counselor for 10 or 11, 12 to 14 year old boys who had never been away from home. So if I tell you that the smell in this cabin, we were in all this little cabin, bunk beds. If I tell you that the smell in this cabin, I still remember it and it still gives me shivers or whatever. So it was crazy. Then at nighttime, because we were there a Sunday through a Friday, kids were so noisy, they wouldn't go to sleep. But then when they fell asleep, there was snoring. It was an amazing experience. I loved it, but it was very loud and smelly. Now, I would go out front and I would check. I checked my email because it had been about 24 hours since I was checking my email. And here's an email that popped on the screen. And it was from a colleague at Cal State University Fullerton, basically asking me if I was interested in teaching. So if you remember, we go all the way back to the story I told you at the beginning. You know, my dad was a professor. I wanted to have nothing to do with being a professor or whatever. But now at this stage in life, I needed to kind of supplement my income because I was DJing full time, doing some social media writing. So I said yes. I said yes and took a creative risk, which was to go and start to teach. And so I ended up teaching. I had to collaborate with a lot of other professors to really learn the system, learn how to teach pretty much, because I had never taught on any level, secondary education, higher education, never. I had to practice resilience. When I got some review scores in my first semester that were really, really low, I had to embrace the failure of getting those low scores. I had to reinvent my classroom numerous times. I had to stay curious because I had to learn, whether it be buying books or learning, listening to podcasts about how to teach better. And I had to be persistent. My persistence paid off in two ways. Eventually, I'm up to my sixth year in teaching. I've become an award-winning professor at Cal State University Fullerton. And my favorite example of persistence is I was able to create a class, a music business class. It took me 3 years to get this class through the system at Cal State Fullerton. We're now on our third semester, full classes each time, and the students are greatly benefiting. And so that's just a story about my experience there. And unfortunately, my dad passed away suddenly 20 years ago. So he never got to see my journey come full circle, and I'm following in his footsteps. It's so very ironic that I tried to get so far away from him, yet I ended up doing exactly what he was doing. I just find that ironic. So with that, I just want you to continue to remember these seven steps for unlocking your creativity. If you're interested in working with me further, I've only shared about 2/7 of my, you know, resilient and brilliant kind of modules, whatever. There's so much more to learn I can teach. Feel free to email me. You can also go to the website right there, amaniexperience.com/call. And we can set up a call. We can talk about maybe how we can work together also. So that's kind of what I wanted to share with you. And then I think we have a little bit of time for questions. You can also connect with me on LinkedIn. You can look up my name, Amani Roberts DJ, Instagram, YouTube, all the things right there. But that is Resilient and Brilliant, 7 Keys to Unlocking Your Creativity.
That is awesome and amazing. Thank you so much, Amani. And this is a book you have coming out, right?
Right. So I have two books coming out. The first book is called The Quiet Storm. It's called A Historical and Cultural Analysis of the Power, Passion, and Pain of R&B Groups. That's coming out in January. Awesome. And then the following year, Resilient and Brilliant will come out, 7 Keys to Unlock Your Creativity. Yes.
Very cool. Well, look forward to reading those. I know that the book of yours that I read, DJs Mean Business, was an awesome read. Yes. And it was a quick and easy read, too. So, you know, make sure you check that out. Yes. So I got a question for you. Every time you played a song there, like, yes, my mind was instantly brought back in time.
Yes.
To a place, to even smells that I started smelling again as you played that. Obviously, that's a big part of DJing. And music has been a big part of your entire life, all the way back from the music that your dad would play on road trips to baseball games. What was it that was so you spent a long time, you know, in the hotel industry. What was that pivotal moment? What was that thing that kind of pushed you towards, I'm going to step away from that and do DJing full time?
I think that what happened is that when my dad passed away 20 years ago, 2004, I was still working for Marriott. And I was like, you know, it's very cliche, but like, you know, tomorrow's not guaranteed. I've been thinking about this for a while because previously I had seen DJ Biz Markie at a club in like 95, 96. And I said, I wanted to do that, but I was too scared to go for it. Mm-hmm. So once this happened and my dad passed away, I said, you know what? Life is too short. We need to kind of figure out a way to make this happen. But it still took me another 3 or 4 years to go for it. But I think that was a pivotal moment, is when I kind of had a wake up call and I realized that life is kind of too short. And I said, let's try to figure out how we can make this happen. So that's kind of what that happened. I am glad that so one of the things I do is I help people unlock their creativity through music and nostalgia. And the fact that it took you back to places and smells and things that you were doing is perfect. My mission was accomplished.
So what piece of advice would you give to anybody who's watching this who says, man, there's something that I really want to go do, but you know, I don't know how to take that step. I don't know what to do. You talked a lot about it a little bit in these 7 steps, but what would you say to those people who are scared to take that step?
Yeah, I would say, first of all, write it down so you can put it down on paper, what you want to do, and then start to research the ways that you can kind of start to accomplish it. And you don't have to leave your job right away. You can start to do it part-time or on the side, but start to research what it would take and then take some steps, one step a month to do it, and then start to build that. Talk to other people who maybe are in the space doing that same thing that you want to do, or maybe you talk to some other people who have made a shift and see how do they do it, what would they change. I find the key is if you can find and surround yourself with people who are like-minded that want to kind of do something different and are looking to make a change, you all can kind of inspire and work with each other. But talk to people, write it down, take one action step, either a week or a month, and eventually you'll get to down the road where you're like, oh, I'm kind of already doing it. Let's continue. And, you know, once you make you get a small win, you just stack your wins, as they say.
Very cool. Appreciate that. Of course. One of the things that blew me away as I was reading through your book was, you know, in my mind, I always thought of a DJ just kind of getting up and playing music. I didn't realize how much a DJ had to have their head on a swivel, paying attention to every single thing going on in the room, looking at the audience, looking at the bartender, looking at the manager, reading what sort of things are going on, and have the technical skills to, if something goes down, if something breaks. You know, it's really interesting to see how you make those parallels to business of, you know, somebody who maybe is a meeting planner, somebody who is in the business world, who we kind of have to have our head on a swivel the same way.
Yeah, exactly. They're very closely related. So to take for a meeting planner, like if something goes wrong, the event can't stop. Like you're not going to stop the conference or the one day meeting, you know, same thing with a DJ. If there's technical issues, speaker goes out, your computer errors, like the music can never stop. And that is a very good, I'm trying to think of the right word for it, but that's like a very good parallel to the meetings and events industry. Like you have to read people, you have to be able to read the room, both literally read the room if you're an event planner, if it's too cold or too hot, but also if people are not engaged, if people are kind of, you know, not really focused, or if people are engaged, you maybe want to extend the session also. So it's like reading a room. There's no two rooms that are ever the same because we're never feeling the same way we were in a specific room. That's very true in DJing and with events. And like, it's just the troubleshooting. The most valuable class I took at Scratch Academy was troubleshooting, because you have to figure out signal flow and you can never let the music stop. And that's so true. And, you know, in our industry, we're pretty much firefighters in our industry. We have to figure out what we need to do to keep things going. I mean, a perfect example would be when we were in Cancun and we did the WEC TV. Like, we were firefighting all day, every day, but no one ever knew because things went so well.
Absolutely. if anybody has any questions for Amani out there in the chat, put them in. I've got one more. Okay. Because I am a giant nerd. I am a huge sci-fi fan. Yeah. And I read something in your book that stuck out to me, in that at one of the shows you were playing, that you were approached by Samuel L. Jackson, Grandmaster Jedi Mace Windu himself, who gave you props at one of your shows. What was that like?
That was surreal. And that was very early on in my career. That was like my first whatever gig. So I kind of got spoiled, because I thought that would happen all the time, but that's very rare. So it was just cool, and I'm glad I put it in the book. And, you know, it gives you a little confidence, but, you know, it didn't happen as much as I thought it would, if I'm being honest. But it was cool, and I remember it. I'll never forget it. I don't think he'll remember who I am, but it's still cool that it happened. We were at the Marina Del Rey Marriott, and I was actually filling in for a DJ that didn't show up. So that's what happened.
Wow. That's wild.
Yeah.
So I was gonna ask you what your favorite failure was, but you already covered that with us.
Ah, okay, yeah.
I was like, oh, dang it, he covered it. I was gonna ask him that and surprise him, but you got me.
I got you.
You've played a lot of DJed in a lot of cool places: LA, Washington, DC, Chicago, Las Vegas, Toronto, Brazil. It's interesting to hear about how you picked up the different music cultures in those different areas, and kind of incorporated that into who you are and what you do. So I think that's really cool. I want to ask a question though, because every DJ has their own look, right? So like me, this is me right here.
Okay. All right. I like it.
But you ended up with bow ties and Adidas.
Yes.
Stan Tell us a little Smith. Bit about how that happened.
I was trying to think. I think I was a friend and I was preparing for like a gig. They're like, you know what, you should kind of, you know, rock the bow ties or whatever. And I love my sneakers. And so I kind of started working with the bow ties and like the suits. And now, like, I'm wearing a pink shirt today, but I have this really cool pink blazer that I'll pair with a bow tie. I have a couple, like a bright green and a bright orange blazer that are coming. So now it's like kind of jeans, dress jeans, blazer, shirt, bow tie, that's my look. I will be honest though, I am getting ready to work with a stylist, so maybe she might change it, or we'll accentuate it, but that's kind of my look. I think we'll keep it, we'll just accentuate it more. It's just stuck with me for a while. It's still pretty unique, you know, it's pretty unique. You don't see too many DJs with the same look, so I'm able to kind of continue to differentiate myself. And then we were talking about music in different areas. Like a good example would be Brazil. One of their favorite genres is baile funk. So I had to learn about that. Gyra, get a couple songs to play. And it's ironic that I think it was Nicki Minaj created a baile funk song recently. And you just have to research Chicago, like really big with house music. DC, where I'm from, go-go music is really big. You know, out in the West Coast, you have like G-funk era. So you just have to know areas of the country, what music really resonates with the local audience, but you got to do your research. And that's really helpful.
Awesome.
Yeah.
Well, Amani, I want to thank you again for your time here with us today. We're just about out of time here. But, you know, hey, make sure you check out Amani and all of the different ways that he has up here. Scan mm-hmm. that QR code, connect with him on Instagram, TikTok, LinkedIn.
Yeah,
scan the QR code here to give feedback and to get today's presentation. And hey, this recording will be out on the MPI webpage. Send it to all your friends, have them check it out, because you know, for me, this is eye-opening for me, because there are certain things that I've wanted to do that I've been afraid to take that step. And it's really inspiring, Amani, to hear your journey and yeah. how that's gone. And it's really cool. So I just want to thank you for your time. Awesome. And for your partnership with MPI. It's awesome to work with you.
Yeah, I love it. We have fun. Miriam asked a question here.
Awesome.
Let's see here. It says, as a corporate event planner, what tips and tricks would you suggest for an inclusion of music in a corporate event and still maintain that seriousness that comes with something new? Okay, great question. I think a couple of ways is that, you know, for a corporate event, definitely as you're getting ready to start the event, maybe the opening general session, you have music playing. Whenever you introduce someone to come to stage, make sure they have a walk-up song. That's really important. That'll kind of continue the energy. Also, when you're having breaks, make sure you properly curate the songs. You generally want to have like up-tempo songs, high BPMs, like 104 and higher. Also, if you're able to get maybe a local artist to come in, if you're able to and you have the budget to get them to kind of share some music or whatever. But DJs work also because they can play local artist music from their decks. But yeah, just always have music kind of in the background, whether it be walk-up music, during breaks, before the session, after the session. If you have it as a common theme throughout, the meeting will still be serious, but people will stay energized, and it really helps people wake up in the morning and then stay awake in the afternoon. And so I think those are kind of two or three tips to have. If you want more, feel free to reach out. But hopefully that helps you, Miriam. Thank you very much for your question.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. All right. Again, want to thank you for your time, Amani.
Awesome.
And this has been really insightful and really eye-opening. And I've got a lot of notes here. I've got a lot of homework that I'm going to go do.
Yes.
Hope everybody out there does your homework too. And be sure, hey, reach out to Amani and let them know your answers to that homework.
Yes. I can't wait.
Come back and put it in the chat of this LinkedIn Live. We'd love to see it.
Yes, yes. Thank you for being a great host and your great questions. And like you said, I love working with MPI for WC. Can't wait for St. Louis next year, maybe even IMEX. So yeah, absolutely.
Absolutely. Great. Thank you so much.
All right. Take care, everyone.
Bye, everybody.